Good evening. I am Vishwanath Praveen, Assistant Head Boy of Indian School Musket. I extend my warmest congratulations to Honorable Union Education Minister, Dr. Ramesh Pokhriyal, for receiving the prestigious Watten International Summit Award. It is my privilege and honor to welcome you, sir, to Avenir 2020. Good evening.
Good evening, one and all. Dear audience, you are requested to fill in the feedback form, which will be posted in the description box. I am Faizan Naji of Class 11E from Indian School Muscat, your host this evening. It's my privilege and pleasure to welcome you all this beautiful evening. Every success story has two beliefs. The future can be better than the present, and we have the power to do it now. Avenir 2020, Be Future Ready, brings new beginnings and new opportunities on a brand new virtual platform this year. A comprehensive project designed and aimed at effectively guiding students and parents to chart out the future course of action after school education. At the outset, on behalf of the Board of Directors, Indian Schools in the Sultanate of Oman, Indian School Muscat, and the entire Indian fraternity, we would like to express a heartfelt gratitude and pay respect to His Majesty Sultan Haitham bin Tariq for his magnanimous benevolence showered on the Indian community. May the Almighty bless His Majesty and the nation with peace and prosperity. I deem it my privilege and pleasure to extend a hearty welcome to Honorable Chairman, Board of Directors, Indian Schools in the Sultanate of Oman, Dr. B.B. Sam Samuel, and Honorable Members on the Board. Mr. Ajay Kumar Pillai, President, Indian School Muscat Management Committee, esteemed members of Indian School Muscat Management Committee, our Honorable Principal, Dr. Rajiv Kumar Chauhan, residents and esteemed members of all Indian School Management Committees in the Sultanate of Oman, Honorable Principals, Vice Principals, Assistant Vice Principals, Supervisors, Coordinators, Heads of Departments, Teachers, Parents, and Students. It's our pride and pleasure to have in our midst a messenger of hope. From a very young age, she has been working for children's rights, promoting gender equality, mitigating climate change, satisfying her passion for spreading the message of peace, happiness, and sustainability. She strives to enlist the support of children and youth from all over the world, especially through the Green Hope Foundation, which she founded when she was only 12, to realize the UN's vision, Leave No One Behind. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Ms. Kehkashan Basu.
Thank you very much. And I...
Feeling that she was destined to become an eco-warrior, since her birthday coincides with the World Environment Day, Ms. Basu started young and has been working to mitigate climate change and promote human rights. By the age of 12, she had garnered international acclaim for her work with the world's youth to spread the message of peace and sustainability. She works tirelessly to integrate the marginalized peoples to help realize the UN's vision, Leave No One Behind. The recipient of a slew of awards and honors, youth leader, environmental activist, powerful motivational speaker, blogger, and author, Ms. Kehkashan Basu wears all these hats with a panache seldom seen in one so young. A warm welcome to you, Ms. Basu.
Thanks to Savio Sebastian Comart of 11D for the fantastic video and Michelle Ellen Joseph of 11C for the voiceover. The stage is all yours, ma'am.
Thank you very much. And I'm very happy to be with all of you here today. I'm going to start by sharing my screen. As was just mentioned, my name is Kehkashan Basu. I am from Toronto, Canada, and I will be sharing my story and talking to you about why it's so important that we as young people take that extra step to help our planet and create that sustainable future that we all so desperately want. So I'm a United Nations Human Rights Champion, a National Geographic Young Explorer, and the council lead of the Toronto St. Paul's Constituency Youth Council Canada. And I'm also the youngest recipient of Canada's top 25 women of influence. My green journey began at the age of 7 when I saw the image of a dead bird with its belly full of plastic. And my 7-year-old brain could not stop thinking about the agony the bird must have gone through before it died. And I knew that there was something very wrong with that image. It should not have happened ever. It was also around that time that I attended a lecture by environmentalist Robert Swan, and his words, "The greatest threat to our planet is the belief that someone else will save it," really resonated with me. And I realized that I had to be the one to take that extra step and create the sustainable future. So I planted my first tree on my 8th birthday, which coincidentally is also World Environment Day. So I always thought that I was predestined to become an eco-warrior. And I worked tirelessly on the ground for about 3 years, going from all around my neighborhood to restaurants, beauty salons, talking to them about switching to more sustainable ways of living and working. And when I was 11, somehow the UN caught hold of what I was doing, and I was invited to speak at my first UN conference in Bandung, Indonesia. And that was my first step into the international arena. And the following year, in 2012, I attended Rio Plus 20 at the age of 12 as one of the youngest delegates and the youngest to address a press conference. And what I realized there was that out of 50,000 delegates, there were only about 5 children who were present there, and most of them older than me. And I realized that there was this severe lack of inclusivity of children in the sustainable development process. So on my return home, I founded Green Hope Foundation to provide children and youth with a platform to learn about sustainability challenges and then learn how to take actions to mitigate these problems. And we do this using education for sustainable development as a transformative tool to engage all of the world's communities, especially the most marginalized. Now, we are at a very crucial stage of our lives, and something that is most relevant right now is that we stand at a critical moment in Earth's history, a time when humanity must choose its future. As the world becomes increasingly interdependent and fragile, the future at once holds great peril and promise. To move forward, we must recognize that in the midst of a magnificent diversity of cultures and life forms, we are one human family and one Earth community with a common destiny. This is the preamble of the Earth Charter, a historic document created by some of the greatest thought leaders of our time 20 years ago that lay the foundation stone and set out the guiding principles for sustainable development to carry forward the aspirations of the 1992 Rio Declaration. Now, 2 decades have elapsed since that day of hope on 29th June 2000, when world leaders pledged to implement the Earth Charter at the Peace Palace at The Hague in the Netherlands. However, we are in 2020, and the words of the Charter still remain just that, mere words with the ground realities probably even bleaker than ever before. Now, The Hague holds a special significance for me personally, as it was also the place at which I was given the honor of receiving the International Children's Peace Prize 4 years ago for championing the cause of children's rights and environmental justice. And as a grassroots crusader, I see and feel the pain every day of the increasing numbers of young people, women, and those from marginalized communities, despite the immense gains in technology. And the irony of the situation is that these impacts can be entirely attributed to us, the human beings, to the short-sightedness of our policies, and to the apathy of both the individual and the community. And the scale and complexity of the environmental fallout as a consequence of economic growth has multiplied with each passing decade. Take the example of the Great Lakes. They hold almost 85% of North America's fresh surface water and a fifth of the world's. Their coastline is longer than the east and west coasts of North America combined. In the 60s and 70s, phosphate in detergents was one of our biggest environmental concerns because it contaminated the Great Lakes. So rivers in Cleveland or Detroit still caught fire then, but comparatively, it was a simpler time. Environmental problems seemed relatively contained, manageable. It seemed that by taking phosphate out of detergent and other pollutants out of a few rivers, we could make the Great Lakes great again. But these days, the threats are more global and daunting than in the olden days of burning rivers. And they come from climate change, which is warming the lakes, diminishing their winter ice cover, and decimating the tiny plankton at the base of the food web. More than 180 invasive species like zebra mussels and sea lampreys have disrupted the food web from top to bottom. Green Hope Foundation's cleanups along these shorelines collect an increasing array of plastics, metal cans, and other litter, most of which should never have reached these waters. You know, people tend to forget about the things that they have thrown away as though they cease to exist when we're finished using them. But material goods don't just disappear, their environmental impact lingers. And the worrying aspect is that this is happening in front of our eyes, yet we cannot see it, or will only notice it when it is too late. For much of the decade of the 1990s and the early 2000s, steady economic progress masked many concerns. The global financial crisis in 2008 and the Great Recession that ensued tore that mask away and generated a greater willingness to examine issues in a new light. And the crisis also unleashed a renewed spirit of multilateral cooperation that was spurred by the necessity of a coordinated and common response and the relative success of the Millennium Development Goals adopted in 2000, which demonstrated what could be achieved through concerted efforts. And there has been increased awareness at all levels that economic success has thus far almost always come at the cost of environmental degradation and damage, and evidence of accelerating environmental degradation and the climate crisis grows more compelling each day. And these global problems require multidimensional and multilateral solutions. And it is the need of the hour to start right now. And the very sad thing is that these global problems, despite needing the collaboration, we are in an era of fragmentation and frustration, and societies are gradually turning away from the spirit of multilateral cooperation. The 2015 adoption of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development and the Paris Agreement on Climate Change created a new developmental paradigm, a blueprint for prosperity, people, and planet predicated on partnerships and multilateralism. As a 15-year-old attending the adoption ceremony of the Sustainable Development Goals in 2015 at the UN General Assembly in New York, as the youngest of the 193 youth selected to represent each UN member state, I remember being so full of hope and aspiration that we finally had global consensus on an action plan that had specific goals and targets that will put the world back on track by the year 2030. And some progress was made in the last 5 years in poverty reduction, in education, in clean energy and biodiversity conservation, but much of it has been wiped away by the impacts of COVID, pushing back particularly the gains made on reducing poverty and inequality. Now, we know that the COVID-19 pandemic is the greatest immediate challenge of our time. And what began as a public health emergency has transformed into the deepest global recession since World War II, as disruptions to production in some countries spread rapidly around the world through global supply chains. And the containment measures to combat the spread of the virus have, in effect, called an unprecedented halt to demand, worsening the economic downturn and directly stopping the income and work in possibly billions of cases around the world. And the sheer size of the crisis threatens everything that has been achieved in the Sustainable Development Goals over the last 5 years, as well as much of the developmental progress made under the MDGs. So depending on how quickly the economies of the world can fully reopen safely and how soon the recovery process can actually begin, hundreds of millions of peoples around the world could be at risk of falling back into poverty. Now, the crisis has also put all of the weaknesses and put forward all of the weaknesses that have hindered the progress on the SDGs into even starker relief. Resource constraints, so the gaps in health systems, public administration and governance systems, and the lack of disaster preparedness have hampered the public response to the outbreak. And in many cases, this has allowed the crisis to spread much more broadly. The pandemic affects us all, but it does not affect us all equally. It has highlighted and deepened the fault lines of existing inequalities among and within countries. And it unerringly has had the greatest adverse impacts on those countries and groups least able to protect themselves and already at greatest risk of being left behind. Green Hope Foundation, as a grassroots organization, is working amongst those vulnerable communities. And we have seen a dramatic rise in school dropouts, of violence, abuse, and trafficking of young girls, and a deepening of the misery and hunger that is taking a huge toll on these communities. And we believe that as damaging as the crisis has been, it is also a huge opportunity. Because for us, the SDGs have always been the blueprint for recovery and Green Hope Foundation's Bangladesh chapter is working to rebuild better amongst these affected communities during the pandemic in the slums of Dhaka, as well as in villages, achieving our objective through education and awareness of building about sanitation, implementing hygiene in their homes, providing resources like soaps, masks, and drinking water storage containers in collaboration with local small and medium business enterprise producers. And in villages where the residents have lost their sources of income working in cities as migrant workers due to the economic slowdown and absence of tourists, we are providing them with the education and resources to embark upon sustainable revenue generation opportunities, so organic farming, livestock rearing, and sustainable fisheries. These villagers also suffer from chronic illnesses, drinking contaminated water, and our project is supplying households with water filters, which for the first time in their lives is providing them with clean drinking water. And we're also providing them with skills-based education, teaching them about sustainable agriculture, poultry farming, helping to establish a local circular economy taken forward mostly by the women that provides a steady revenue stream for the villages that will have a direct impact on their resilience through improved nutrition, sanitation and hygiene, biodiversity conservation, as well as addressing the education needs of the parents as well as the children. So we are not waiting for governments to act or for policy changes to be implemented for addressing these issues. Neither are we protesting or striking on Fridays. That is not our modus operandi. Each of us at Green Hope believes that we are accountable and should take on the responsibility of driving change. And that is our mantra, bringing change one child at a time. And while we continue our grassroots advocacy, we also amplify the call for greater policy commitments at the highest levels of decision-making and governance. And in the last 6 months with the world in lockdown, Green Hope Foundation has organized more than 30 high-level webinars, bringing together multidisciplinary experts from different United Nations processes, heads of governments and presidents, such as the former president of Ireland, civil society actors. We have been on panels with CEOs of global conglomerates like Procter & Gamble, driving home the message that the new normal demands new commitments, a new vision, and a new way of doing business. We have to accept that the rising risk of transmitting zoonotic viruses such as COVID-19 is largely due to human-induced environmental change, such as forced cover conversion and increased interactions between human settlements and nature. And addressing this upward trend will necessarily involve understanding complex interactions between human society and ecological systems. So for this, we must harness technology for equitable benefit. We have to redress the fact that currently digital dividends coexist with digital divides. Digital technologies can help tackle challenges posed by major demographic trends. So population growth, urbanization, and aging propel the development of technologies to enhance physical and cognitive capacities and allow older people to work longer. And at the same time, more and better automation of agriculture, manufacturing, and services can mean that a shrinking workforce will start to produce enough to support a larger aging population. So our call is for an equality lens to policymaking. And while the role of governments and other national stakeholders remains key to fighting inequality, along with grassroots actions, in an interconnected world, national policymaking is increasingly constrained by the decisions of other countries and transnational firms. Therefore, cooperation among countries remains essential for ensuring equitable and inclusive development, not least because the consequences of rising inequality and unsustainable growth do not respect national borders. And we as individuals must shrug off this indifference and be willing to be held accountable. You have to remember that it will take all of us to come out of this crisis and this chain of overconsumption, because every action you take or choose not to take has an impact. So I urge you to break this vicious cycle of overconsumption and wastage and try to do more with less. The word impossible is a human creation because it is up to us to set our limits. I started Green Hope Foundation 8 years ago at the age of 12. Today, we have a presence in 16 countries. We are accredited by the United Nations. Our work has elevated the lives of over 120,000 vulnerable people in 25 countries. We have planted over 110,000 trees, 5,000 mangroves, recycled over 200,000 kilos of waste, worked extensively on turtle conservation, sea and river, cleaned up over 165 beaches, ravines, communities. We have empowered the world's most vulnerable, Syrian refugees, Rohingya refugees, children of prisoners in Nepal and Kenya, children in orphanages in Suriname and Indonesia, and HIV positive children in Nepal. And there is a change maker in each and every one of us. You just have to make the choice. Now, more than ever before, it is time for us to reaffirm our commitment in letter and in spirit to the Rio Declaration, the Future We Want document, which served as the blueprint of the Sustainable Development Goals. And let us use this pandemic as an opportunity to create a new social contract. Multilateralism is the way forward. And the success of the SDGs depends on each and every one of us, and we cannot allow the pandemic to slow us down. We need to rebuild better and stronger so that we can truly achieve the UN's mandate of leaving no one behind and ensuring a life of dignity for all. And we, the youth, must make ourselves so powerful that no one can ignore us. And for that, we have to educate ourselves. We also need to learn from the wisdom of our elders. Criticizing them will not solve our problems. Intergenerational solidarity is essential for a sustainable future. So let us not waste time in just shouting slogans, but use that time to help another person in a vulnerable community and ensure that the 165 million children for whom education is a privilege are able to rightfully claim their birthright to quality education. There is so much to do, but such little time. Each one of us needs to start our day with a pledge to do one act of kindness for the community and the planet. Our cumulative efforts will surely yield results. And we, the youth, have the power to mold the future the way we want it. So, armed with your knowledge, be fearless, be focused, be honest, and be empathetic. And as Swami Vivekananda said, a brave, frank, clean-hearted, courageous, and aspiring youth is the only foundation on which the future nation can be built. Thank you very much.
Ma'am, your words were truly encouraging, and most certainly it is a great honor to have you with us this evening. Dear audience, a gentle reminder, you are requested to fill in the feedback form, which will be posted in the description box. We now begin with the question and answer session. Ma'am, at 12, when most children are playing with video games and cricket, you were selected for UNEP, the United Nations Environment Program. Can you please share your success journey and how such a selection has changed you as a person?
Absolutely. So yes, at the age of 12, I was elected as Global Coordinator for Children and Youth at the United Nations Environment Program. And I worked tirelessly on the ground for 4 years before that, as I mentioned. And when the appointment came and when I was elected into this position, it made me the youngest person and the only minor to ever hold this position. And what I liked most about this election was that the people who had elected me not based on my age, but on the work that I had done, on the 4 years of experience that I had. And as global coordinator, I was the liaison between the United Nations and the Children and Youth Fraternity. And that enabled me to learn so much about how the high-level processes function and how it is absolutely crucial to bring those high-level processes to the ground level. And becoming the global coordinator, of course, changed my life because it opened up so many different avenues for me, but it also made sure that I understood why it's so important to bridge the opportunity gap and why it's so important to reach the farthest first and bring the voices of the most vulnerable to the forefront. And that is exactly what Green Hope does. And it was, I think, a coincidence as well, that I started Green Hope Foundation and became global coordinator at exactly the same age. So both of them enabled me to grow and learn over time.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, how can each of us participate to enforce the Sustainable Development Goals?
You know, the SDGs are not this far away agenda. It is something that is ingrained in our daily lives. So any action that you take contributes towards the achievement of the SDGs. That can be as simple as maintaining good health and well-being, because that is SDG 3, ensuring that everyone has access to education, SDG 4, implementing gender equality in all aspects of life, SDG 5, or even taking environmental actions, whether that's planting trees, so SDGs 13 and 15, or just working towards peace and sustainability, just SDG 16. And that is exactly what we try to do at Green Hope Foundation, to localize the SDGs and see what is the most relevant to each region, and thereafter we take forward the work and work with the people on the ground to figure out which SDGs they can implement best on the ground. So there is a lot that can be done, whether it is changing your eating habits or planting trees or saving water or ensuring a child's education, and all of which contribute towards the achievement of the SDGs, because the 5 P's of the SDGs, one of the most important parts of that is people. So it cannot happen without us. It has to start from the ground level.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question from the audience is, do you have a message for the young people who would like to follow their ambitions at a young age?
Sure. I think that it is not about starting an organization or going international just like that. It is about changing your own lifestyle towards making it more sustainability oriented and practicing what you preach, because only when you start with the individual can you influence the collective. So I would say that start by thinking about what you have done to help your community and your planet. And if your conscience gives you a negative answer, you know that there is a lot more that you can do to take that extra step to create that sustainable future. So my message would be to not be afraid to step out of your comfort zone, and that the smallest actions count the most. And only when we all take those small actions, only then can we truly achieve a sustainable future. And that has to be driven by children and young people.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, how has your work progressed over the years, and what do you intend to do in the future?
So as I just mentioned during my presentation, Green Hope Foundation has grown from a 12-year-old dream with just 5 members to over 120,000 young people globally. And throughout our work, we've been able to increase our impact to different countries and work particularly with the marginalized communities from Kenya to Suriname. And in the future, my goal is to have Green Hope in every country of the world, but not tokenistically. I want every single person to adopt sustainable living as a way of life, and a world where sustainability becomes the normal. It is not something that you have to do separately or something that you're told to do. It just becomes a way of life. That is what we try to do at Green Hope, and it is our hope that in the future, the world would also have the same mindset.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question from our audience. As a 12-year-old, what all were the challenges you faced with your age?
Sure. So the first challenge was that my age was seen as a barrier, as some people. Honestly, I never saw it that way, but a lot of people did not understand how a 12-year-old could do so much, or why a 12-year-old was present there. What they did not realize was, as I mentioned earlier, age has nothing to do with capability. So there was this mindset that I had to fight against, this rigid mindset that change can only be brought about by adults. Change can be brought about by everyone, and that is exactly what I proved through my work. As a child as well, I also faced tremendous cyberbullying, harassment from older youth and their people, stalking, death threats, threats of physical abuse, all the things that come with doing good work. And it started actually when I was 10 and when I actually got into this field of sustainability. But what I also realized at that time was that when you do good work, there are always going to be naysayers, and people are always going to try to pull you down, and you're going to be a threat to many people. And I realized that my love and passion for my work was more than my fear of these naysayers. And that actually enabled me to overcome these challenges. So there are challenges all throughout. Even now, I face the exact same things. But that also made me realize that Green Hope had to be a safe space for people and children around the world so that everyone could follow their dreams and achieve their passion. So yeah, my challenges have been there, but they've also influenced my way of thinking and my way of doing things with Green Hope.
Thank you, ma'am. Were you supported by your family in the initial stages?
Yes, absolutely. I would not be where I am today if I did not have my parents' support. And the best part is that I grew up looking at my parents and my grandparents and seeing them have sustainable living as a way of life. So for me, that was the normal. And when I saw the image of the dead bird, that was when I realized that it wasn't normal for other people. And when I told my parents that I wanted to start this journey and embark upon my sustainability journey, they were the most supportive ever. And they just told me to follow my dream and do what I was most passionate about. So they continue to work with me to this day. And they served as my inspiration for knowing that sustainable living can become a way of life. We just have to change that mindset. So yes, my parents have supported me all throughout, and especially during the times when I faced all of those challenges and didn't know what to do as a 12-year-old facing this onslaught of hate from people. And it was from them that I learned how to overcome these challenges and move past all of these negative thoughts and emotions through positivity, honesty, hard work, empathy, and of course, love and passion for my work.
Ma'am, moving on to the next question from the audience. Climate change is real and it is happening as we speak. So if there is one thing that we can change in our lives that will help in protecting our environment, what should that be according to you?
I think the one thing is shaking off the apathy that is still in our mindsets, and the whole adage of thinking that someone else is gonna solve the problem. I'm not gonna say that there is one physical solution that can help everyone, because every region and every community face different challenges. So while one might be applicable to one community, it might actually have a negative impact on another place. Take mangrove planting, for example. In Hawaii, it's seen as an invasive species. In the Sundarbans, it's seen as a positive. But what we can change is our mindset that someone else is gonna do it for us and someone else will solve this global problem. No, once we change that, we can actually achieve sustainable development. We've seen it throughout history that once we have brought about this change in mindset, slowly and steadily, we have been able to progress and achieve our goal. So yes, the one thing I would say is shaking off that apathy and indifference and taking the actions today. And it's not just for climate change, it's for all the issues that face our world today. They're interconnected. But yes, any issue you want to solve, it has to start with you.
Thank you, ma'am. How can children like us become an environmentalist? And what were the obstacles you faced across the years?
I think an environmentalist exists within each and every one of us. And we just have to, again, mindset change, where you take an action and you also think about the society and the environment while you're taking that action. So that is literally how you can become an environmentalist. And then of course you start by taking actions on the ground. So in Oman, for example, there are so many different opportunities to be able to take forward environmentalism and sustainability, whether it is tree planting or beach cleanups or turtle conservation. And the challenges are many, but the opportunities are also many. And there's a lot that can be done in your daily lives to implement the SDGs personally, as well as with your school and with your community. And the challenges, like I said, still a mindset change that maybe it is not lucrative to invest in young people. Maybe it is not, like, young people are of a certain mindset and tokenizing them is the way forward. So these challenges are things that I face even today. And that is what we work to dispel at Green Hope through our work at the ground level in proving that every child and every person can become a change maker.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question, can I start my organization starting with my family as its members?
Yes, absolutely. Like I also mentioned before, it's about getting people involved, and whether you want to call it an organization or just a community effort, it's not so much the name that counts, but the actions that are taken. So yes, if you want to start doing something for the planet, more than, you know, labeling it as an organization or an initiative, you have to start with the work, and that will automatically create that initiative or organization for you. And only after you've done the work can you put the label on it as organization. So if you and your family are interested and want to create positive change for the environment, start taking actions. And yes, you can definitely label that then as an organization. So yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question from the audience, how can we strengthen our voice or make our voice heard to the people to understand that we want to contribute to the society or the environment?
Well, that is through our work. And I'm citing Green Hope's example again, because as young people, there are a lot of challenges that we face, the foremost amongst which is the rigid mindset. So in order to get our voices heard and prove that we are citizens of the planet and there is a lot that we can do, the proof has to come through our work. So when I was younger and people did not thought they would not take me seriously, it was my work that backed me up and proved that no matter how old I was, it was the work that counted and the positive impact that I had made. So I would say that it's all about, to get your voices heard, it's all about having the ground level work to back you up. That can come in different forms, but that is exactly how you go forward. And also realizing that if you truly want to make a difference, you're not gonna stop just because someone told you no. You keep going and keep going, and only then can you actually see that change created. Because if I had stopped when someone tried to threaten me, I would not be here right now. But I chose to move past that, taking precautions, of course, and realizing that you have to just keep going if you're truly passionate about your dream.
Thank you, ma'am. Moving on to the next question. Ma'am, what motivated you to start Green Hope?
So like I mentioned, it was the lack of inclusivity of children in the sustainable development process that I witnessed at Rio+20 in Brazil. And for me, that was very shocking because I knew for a fact through my ground level work over the 4 years prior to that, that children were the most enthusiastic about taking actions to protect our planet, taking actions to help out our community. And it was very surprising and shocking for me to see that at all of these big global fora, young people children specifically, were not represented and our voices were not heard. So that is what inspired me to start Green Hope. I had already been working on the ground 4 years before that, but then I realized that there was a lot that we could do as well that I could do to involve other children and youth in the sustainability crusade. So that is why I started Green Hope Foundation.
Thank you, ma'am. Moving on to the final question for this evening. Ma'am, do you have a message for those of us in Oman? And are there any events conducted by you where we can participate?
Yes, of course. My message again is that take that extra step, walk that extra mile to get the future you want, whether you're in Oman or anywhere else in the world. But in Oman, once again, there is so much potential for you to create change. And yes, Green Hope Foundation does have and Oman chapter, which is one of our most active. So you can definitely get involved with us. If you register on our website, greenhopefoundation.com, we can put you in touch with the Oman Green Hope members, many of whom are actually from ISM. So yes, there is so much that you can do, and we'd love to have many more of you get involved in these initiatives and take forward the work towards sustainable development.
Thank you so much for your brilliant answers, ma'am. Dear audience, that brings us to the close of this evening's session, and it's only appropriate to close with a word of thanks. Gratitude is the fairest blossom which springs from the soul, and if the only prayer you ever say is thank you, that will be enough. On behalf of Indian School Muscat, I stand before you to propose the word of thanks. A very good evening to one and all. As we draw to the culmination of this stimulating event, I am deeply honored to propose the word of thanks. Let me first express a profound gratitude to His Majesty Sultan Haitham bin Tariq for the magnanimous benevolence showered on the Indian diaspora in the Sultanate of Oman. May the Almighty shower abundant blessings on His Majesty. We wish to express a heartfelt thanks to Ms. Kehkashan Basu, the founder of Green Hope Foundation, to realize the UN's vision, Leave No One Behind. Your illuminating ideas and distinct vision most certainly ignited the young minds and empowered them to gain much more clarity about their future prospects. Thank you very much, ma'am. Our deepest appreciation and gratitude to Dr. Baby Sam Samuel, Chairman, Board of Directors, Indian Schools, other esteemed members on the board, Mr. Ajay Kumar Pillai, President, Indian School Muscat Management Committee, revered members of the School Management Committee, Indian Schools, Sultanate of Oman, Principal Dr. Rajiv Kumar Chauhan, Honorable Principals, Vice Principals, Assistant Vice Principals, Heads of Departments, Teachers, students, invitees, grandparents, parents, and well-wishers. Your gracious presence made the session all the more gratifying. Thank you, sirs and ma'ams. My sincere thanks to my Indian School Muscat team, who has worked behind the scenes for the success of Avenir 2020. Signing off for now, this is Faizan Najib of Class 11E from Indian School Muscat. Wishing you all the very best in your future endeavors. Good evening. Stay safe.